I know I've taken a little break from YouTube, but it's because we've traveled here from Tucson, and like I said in my update video, it was a much bigger endeavor than I thought it would be. We were in the car for at least 38 hours straight driving from Toronto here to Tucson. We rented our house back home in Toronto, so we had to get the house ready, which went, there's always way more into that than I realized. And then we got a vacant place down here because we wanted to buy our own furniture because we know we're gonna be coming back and eventually buying a place down here. The only reason we haven't is because I think our money's better served in the Toronto real estate market right now. I could blab on and on about that, but this video, we're gonna answer your questions. I got a bunch of questions here that you guys asked both of us, and I'm gonna show you our biggest giveaway ever. I got a bunch of stuff here that I'm giving away, and I'm really excited about that. I'm gonna answer your questions real quick, and then I'm gonna show you the stuff, and stay tuned because I'm gonna be uploading more videos a week. I'm gonna go for at least 3 to 4 videos a week while I'm here in Tucson. Let's get into the questions, and we're gonna both answer them if we think it's applicable. If not, maybe one of them will just answer because I think some of them are just directed at my wife. Her name is Deirdre. I saw in one of the comments, what's your wife's name? Her name is Deirdre. So here we go. Question number one, should I do base miles? My previous coach would have me do periodization, which a lot of pro athletes do, which is take a month off at the end of the year, you do base miles for the first couple months, you start doing threshold intervals, the more pointy intervals. And this year is gonna be the first year that I don't do that, and I'm already feeling better. I've showed up here to Tucson fitter than I've ever been, and I feel amazing. And it's because I didn't take that break off. And what my coach told me, my current coach, who is hands down the best coach I've ever had, his name's Tom Danielson, cinch.cc if you're interested. And he says, you know, you take a month off, it's gonna take you 3 months, 4 months to get that fitness back. And that's what I was dealing with. And especially last year really hit me hard because I'm getting older. I turned 39 last year and it took me at least 6 months to get my fitness back. And it's such a mind, like it screwed my mind up because I'm like, oh, am I over the hill? Is my fitness gone? Am I ever gonna get it back? Because I never had that happen before. I was always making gains, but I just took too much time off. I was off the bike for like a month or something. So base miles, yes, I think they're important. I think
especially for a beginner.
Beginner, yeah.
They 100%. Really need to build that base.
Yeah, and I think it depends on where you are.
First few years.
Yeah, I think it depends on where you are in your cycling or triathlon career, but at the beginning it's important. And I think just trying different types of training is important because sometimes I think you try a certain type of training and then switching to a different type, just that switch gives you that adaptation, right? So I think the most important thing is if you're really serious about training and to try and find a coach. I know you can get a coach for like 100, 150 bucks a month, you know, a beginner coach. But obviously if you're not serious about training, you can, you know, and I know it's a touchy topic. Anytime I say get a coach in the video, they're like, oh, what if you can't afford it? We can figure out ways to afford things we really want. So if it's something you really want to really get fitter, you gotta get a coach, you gotta get a power meter. These are things that you have to have. Any serious cyclist or a serious endurance athlete has a coach. And I don't mean like they have some type of coach and they have a power meter. They have this stuff because, you know, you can't really train without it. And because I find there's two different types of athletes. They're the type that are super motivated and they need a coach to pull them back. That's what I need. And then there's other athletes that need to be motivated that have a lot of talent that need to go, hey, you need to do this workout. Hey, you need to start training. So that's why a coach is super important.
And also joining a cycling club.
Yeah, cycling team.
Like weekly ride, right? That will help you with interval training.
Yeah, club, team, motivation. Group ride, anything like that. I find training with others super huge. I love group rides. They motivate the heck out of me. All right, question number two. What bike does Mrs. Maloney have? Deirdre, we got it behind us here. I'll throw up some B-roll of it, but she's got the Trek Amanda SLR with the red E-tap axis, the triple X bars, and some DT Swiss wheels. It's a great bike. I think we're gonna upgrade the wheels. I got them on order from Bontrager, but like everything right now, it takes 6-8 months to get stuff, sometimes years. It's a nice bike. Same bike I have, actually. All right, question number three. Are there conditions in the winter where I will not ride outside? Yes. Obviously the road conditions, once there's snow on the ground, you can't ride because it's dangerous. I would ride outside like -2, -3 degrees Celsius, which would be 28 degrees Fahrenheit if it's dry. I think anything below 10 degrees Celsius, which would be like 45 Fahrenheit, wet, you can't go out there. Like maybe you could do an hour or two if like you have all the proper gear, but I've tried so many ways to keep my hands and feet dry. And if you're out there for longer than 2 hours, you're gonna suffer. And even if you get down, like I think the absolute worst weather is 3 degrees, 2 degrees Celsius, 35 degrees Fahrenheit, raining. I'd rather it be -5 or 25 and dry.
Mm-hmm.
So
I'm a fair weather rider. I do not like going out in the cold.
Once it reaches like 12 degrees Celsius.
Yeah, but I have a lot of respect. I have a few teammates. They ride outdoors all winter long. They have fat bikes and mountain bikes, and they just put, they got their winter boots on and all their gear. And I'm like, holy smokes, you guys are hardcore. I like Zwift though. I enjoy getting on the trainer. So, you know, I like mixing it up. So for me, it's not a problem.
Yeah.
To do that.
Zwift races are the only thing I do on the trainer. I can't do the workouts. I just, the last 2 weeks leading up to coming here, I just basically did Zwift races, and that's what got me through it. Cause I hate the trainer. I absolutely hate it. And if there was a way for me to never ride it again, I would. Because even if you're gonna do an hour easy spin on the trainer, it's 100 times harder than doing it like say here in Tucson. You ride out, ride out in 30 minutes, grab a coffee, ride home. Done. And it doesn't feel like, on the trainer I find it feels 4 times longer than it does riding outside. You know,
I like the convenience of it.
Yeah, but that's not to say you can get in your zone. And if I didn't have the opportunity to come here mm-hmm. and ride out here, I probably would be on the trainer. We back home, they have like studios where like 10 people show up and they all ride on the trainer together. So I would definitely be doing stuff like that.
And, yeah, those were fun.
Yeah, I did that before.
We had a lot of fun doing those. Yeah.
Yeah. I know you're a big Trek fan, but what about other brands you have bought before? Would you ever purchase a Specialized? Yeah, I'd purchase a Specialized 100%. I've bought a Cannondale. I've bought BMC. Bought a Norco bike. You've had Felt Bike.
Yeah.
You're sponsored.
I've had a couple Felt Bikes. I like them.
Yeah. I love Trek, and I have a great relationship with Trek. And I think they're an amazing brand. And the reason I go with Trek is because I have that relationship with them. And if you have a local Trek shop that you can get in and talk to them and build a relationship with, I'm sure you could build a relationship with them. But to me, that's what's important, that I have someone that I could call and say, hey, can you help me out here? Can you get me this part? I want this bike. And there's someone, you know, that works at the shop, that owns the shop and says, yeah, I can get this for you. And that's how I was able to get these bikes. Are there other brands? Yeah, I'd be interested in other brands, but I wouldn't leave Trek because I've had it since the beginning of my cycling. I've had a relationship with Trek. A friend introduced me to the owner of the Trek store for the first bike I wanted to buy, and I haven't left. That's why I'm with Trek, and that's why I love Trek. And maybe I'd be with another brand if that person they introduced me to was a Specialized guy, but I have never had a reason to leave Trek because of my relationship with the people that work for Trek. And plus their products, I can't find anything wrong with their products.
Mm-hmm. Well, and the higher end bikes are made in the US, so.
They're assembled in the US.
Oh, assembled, I thought the.
I don't think any of the big brands are made in the US. All the carbon's made in China.
I thought they were made in the US.
Assembled.
High end, oh.
So all the other bikes are assembled in, like their high end bikes, they get all the parts and then assemble them here in the US.
Well, that's not something to toot your horn about.
We're not even going to talk about the China-made stuff right now. We're not even going to get into that. Let's go to the next question. The cycling channel. Where is the best balance for you two between bikes, kids, etc.?
Yeah, I think the most important thing for us is that we carve out alone time. Yeah. So whether it be like going for a ride together or going out for date night at the restaurant. If we don't do those things, then you start to see like the stress build up in the relationship, like the tension, maybe like borderline getting close to some resentment. Because it's easy, right? When you have so many kids and you're both like so motivated in your sport, it's easy to just kind of do your own thing. So I find like date nights, which we're doing this Friday, are so super important and keep the relationship healthy. And communication, we need to talk a lot, which isn't difficult for him, but it's harder for me. I have a hard time sometimes expressing myself. So that's something we've had to work on, where he's had to like tone it back a bit and not put so much pressure on me, and I've had to like step it up.
What actually happened is we started going away on like 3-4 week vacations. And when I wasn't on those vacations, I really didn't spend much time with my kids. I might tuck them in at night. And then on those vacations, I was spending this time with the kids, and I enjoyed it so much. And what my childhood was terrible. My parents would fight every day, and like the memories of my mom waking me up in the middle of the night and taking me to a hotel because she got into a big fight with my dad, and then her sitting on the bed crying, and then we go home 3 days later and her saying sorry. And it was just, I grew up in a really, and that's the nice stuff. I grew up in a really bad, like my father resented having kids, and he told me to my face, I wish I never had kids because you guys ruined my life. And I wanted to stop that cycle. So when I spend the time with the kids and I realize that I can make their lives, I can help make their lives so much better by teaching them all the stuff that I learned, and then they can go out and learn their own stuff and they can be better than me. And that's what made me retire early. And then the cycling is what I did to keep me busy while being with the kids. That makes sense, right?
And burn off your energy.
And burn off my energy.
It's like super high energy. I think you guys picked that up. Yeah. He needs to ride his bike every day or he gets like a little antsy.
Then I fell in love with cycling. So that was the whole lifestyle that we wanted to create, is I ride my bike a couple hours a day and then spend the time with my kids. And we do a lot of constructive stuff with our kids. Like we have them in jiu-jitsu, horseback riding.
We incorporate
riding.
Them into, like Charlie's will do easy spins with one of us. Jonathan goes for little runs with me. So it's nice that we can kind of put them into the mix a little bit.
Yeah, they're part of our lifestyle because neither of us grew up with parents. Like, we just didn't talk to our parents, you know what I mean? In terms of our relationship, it's like she said, what happens is if we don't spend alone time together, she feels neglected. I get in my zone and just think everything's okay and kind of go inside myself. She builds up a resentment. I think that everything's fine. Then she starts getting mad. I ask her for what's for dinner. Cook your own fucking dinner. And I'm like, hey, what's wrong? And then I realize we need that alone time. Because I think it's easy to, even though you live with someone, mm-hmm. to neglect the person emotionally because everyone's so busy.
And it's easy to skip that time because, like with the kids, like for me especially, I always feel guilty. I always feel like I'm not doing enough for the kids, and we got to take them places and spend all our time with them, even though we already do. So, yeah, it's hard to balance it all, but we seem to make it work. We're going to find out in 15 years when the kids are older whether or not that's true.
All right, next question. Are you guys plant-based? So we were plant-based. I was plant-based for 5 years. And then I just started doing some research, and I was worried that I could be missing nutrients not eating meat. And so 90 to 95% of my diet's plant-based. The only meat I will eat is lean meat, is lean chicken and lean beef. I don't eat cheese, I don't eat eggs.
Yeah, plant-based. And then if we're out, we used to ask, was this cooked on the same grill, or is there eggs in the pasta? And now we just don't ask those questions. When we go out to eat, we just eat and enjoy ourselves, and then eat mostly plant-based, because we find getting like that, lots of like fruits, vegetables, like high content like that is really important for recovery and hydration and just feeling good. I've never felt better than when I ate a fully raw diet, actually. So I know how important those fruits and vegetables are to get in. So
I don't know if that's sustainable though. I think like you could have felt good for a month, but like if you stayed fully raw for 2 years, it could have. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean?
Well, it's like one of those things when you said earlier about switching your coaches around or switching your workouts around, you're going to notice like an improvement. And so I think maybe the same for the diet, where I went on this raw diet and I felt so amazing because like all of a sudden I had this rush of nutrition coming into my body. And then, you can switch to something else. Like now I'm focused on high protein and I notice a huge shift, yeah. Right? And I'm feeling really good and my workouts are going great. One of the things I'm doing is I have a protein shake before bed. I just do like unsweetened almond milk with one scoop of protein powder, plant-based protein. And I've been finding that's really good. It's helped me manage my weight better. I've been able to stay leaner and I'm not as hungry and I feel satisfied. So I think maybe as getting older, like increasing the protein is really important, especially for women.
What do you get out of coaching in terms of road cycling? Is it just training plans, optimizing your fitness, or can you be coached in bike handling skills, group ride, etc.? Yeah, so I've always had a coach in cycling because I just felt like it was important. Like I needed someone to guide me because I had no clue, especially at the beginning.
And you had different types of coaching. So where you've had coaches that were like hands-on where you would actually go out for rides with them.
Yeah.
Which could be really beneficial. So if you find someone local, maybe through your cycling club, that can actually ride with you, you can learn so much about proper drafting, where to be.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Even I remember going on a group ride and one of our coaches was there and he's like, okay, you got to get down on the drops, get behind this guy, follow me. And it was just, it just made things so much easier. And I started like understanding better because you had that person there, you know, guiding you.
The more I got into cycling, the less hands off, the more hands off the coach was because I learned more. But at the beginning, if you could have a coach that you can go out and meet and like teach you that stuff. But I think what happens with cycling is like, if I look back, the learning curve is so steep. Like it just to learn the nuances, like the etiquette, you know, what to do in a race, what to do in a group ride, you know, how to handle yourself, bike handling skills. Like I think it took 2 or 3 years for me to feel comfortable riding inside to the curb with riders all around me, just on a group ride, worrying that they're gonna put me into the ditch, right? The best advice I can give is take it slow, know it's a long road to like really learn this stuff, and just go out, enjoy it, and try and learn as much as you can from different people. Go on group rides, go on club rides, do a race, talk to different coaches, see if you can find a coach that's, like we said, in your area that's a reasonable price. And just remember, it's a long road, and to try and enjoy it because it takes years. Like, I'm still learning. I've been doing it 7, 8 years, and I'm still learning stuff, right? So I would look at it like that. It's a long journey, especially those first couple of years.
Yeah, but I know at some mountain bike, like where we are, they have skills clinics there. So where you're, you know, learning how to, I guess, even just stand on the bike and hop over curbs and things like that. So
joining a club is huge because like they have a back home in Toronto, and I'm sure they have something here. They have the midweek crit, the midweek right club. I think it's called midweek club.
Yeah.
And they have skills a night where it's just skills and drills. So everyone gets together and then they do skills and drills and they have like leaders teaching you how to do different stuff.
And specific, like they have a cross one, they have a crit one.
Yeah.
Yeah, so definitely look for what different cycling clubs are doing in your area. Those are great.
All right, next question. Oh, this is a good one. If you could go for a ride with any pro cyclist, who would it be?
I'd probably choose Lance Armstrong.
Really?
Yeah, why not?
I'll tell you who I'd like to go on a ride with. He's not a pro cyclist, so I hope this doesn't answer your question. I hope this answers your question. Mike Tyson. I really love Mike Tyson.
You'd want to go on a ride with him?
Just to talk to him. That's the guy I want to talk to.
You would do easy spin with Mike?
Easy spin with Mike Tyson. Now, and I'll tell you why. Because this is kind of be a long answer, but you take Mike Tyson in his prime. He had $500 million. He was the baddest man on the planet. He could beat anyone up. How do you get higher than Mike Tyson? And he lost it all. He ended up in prison, lost all his money. He had a death, his daughter died. And now it seems like he's doing better than he ever has. Everyone hated him. Now people love him.
Yeah,
right?
He's so humble.
He's so humble. He talks about his ego and he has overcome more in his lifetime than I probably would in 3 lifetimes. And just to sit down and hear the man talk and like, just to really, you know, ask him questions and get to know him, because he's been through more than, you know, almost anyone. And to come out on top, I think is absolutely amazing. And that's what I love about the guy.
Yeah.
I love Mike Tyson.
Yeah, so do I. Yeah, I think, I kind of feel the same for Lance. Like, I know he's controversial, but like the amazing stories he would be able to tell you about his life, like going through cancer and coming back and, you know, regardless of the controversy, it would just be so interesting to like hear his life story, right?
And so you like him for the same reasons where he's admitted that he was an asshole.
Yeah, he was like able to overcome it all. And you know, now he has his podcast and you know, he didn't let it like shrink him away.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it'd just be an interesting story.
Yeah, it's true. Cause I think if that happened to most people, they wouldn't.
Oh, they would disappear.
Yeah.
Of course.
So the fact that he's still out there and people, he's making a comeback. Yeah, that's a good point. Same reason I like Mike Tyson. All right, I think we got one more question. are there great roads to cycle in Tucson? So why are we here in Tucson? So I think that's a great last question. Here are the main reasons Tucson. Number one, the weather. The weather here is like, you don't even check the weather because every day there's not gonna be a cloud in the sky and the weather is consistent. You know exactly what it's gonna be. It doesn't change. And it's sunny, it's beautiful, it's warm, it's cold in the mornings, but besides that, the weather is amazing. Number two, because of the weather, all the best riders come down here. So you have all these amazing guys to ride with. Not only amazing, but there's tons of people to ride with. Like I think, how many guys were on the shootout 2 days ago? 50 people, at least?
Yeah, 40, 50.
And sometimes it can go up 80, 90, 100, right? So the people, it has Mount Lemmon. Mount Lemmon's awesome. It's just an amazing climb. You can go over there, do intervals all day long, go right up to the top.
Well, it's amazing because you start on the bottom and it's a desert. And then as you make your way up, you get into this like coniferous forest, which is so beautiful. And there's snow and you feel like you're in a different land.
There's a ski lift up
there. So you get to see the change as you go up. It's really cool.
And there's a bunch of other reasons, but then bike path, yeah.
Like over 200 kilometers of paved, beautiful bike paths.
Yeah, that like links the whole city, that like wraps around the whole city, and you could do a 4-hour ride on the bike path, no problem. All right, let's get to the giveaway. So all this stuff I'm giving away, free to enter. All you gotta do is click on the link, enter your information, and you're entered to win. Number one, heated socks. They come with batteries and a little remote control to do low, medium, high. They are called Komodo, I think. The brand will be in the description. It's number one. Number two is a Dura-Ace 9200 crank. It's a 170. 9200 crank, no chain rings. SRAM Red multi-clicks. These are awesome. They're one of my favorite things about SRAM, these multi-clicks. Absolutely amazing. If you don't know what they are, Google them. If you have SRAM, these are a must. Ticker, heart rate strap, a set of Wira Hex Plus Allen keys, SRAM blips, similar to the multi-clicks, my wife's cookbook. You can buy these too if you want. I'll put the link in the description. A never used Aeolus saddle. This is the carbon, the pro model. And the size is 143. This is the pro model, like I said. And then the last thing, our absolute black round chain rings, 5339. Again, each one is gonna be a separate giveaway, all with its own link. You can enter all, each person can enter all giveaways if you like. I'm really excited. This is the biggest giveaway I've done. I bought all this stuff myself because all this stuff is stuff that I would love to have. Please. Enter. I'm really happy that you guys are giving this stuff away. That's it. Anything you want to say?
And share this video with your cycling friends so they can have a chance to enter to win too.
Yeah. All right, guys, stay tuned. Please hit the subscribe button if you like these videos so you can be notified for future videos. Please like the video if you liked it and please comment. I read all my comments and stay tuned. I got lots of videos coming from here in Tucson. We're here for the next 5 months. I will see you guys soon. I'll see you on the next video.
Peace.
Bye.